You can taste the dishonesty, it's all over your breath as you pass it off so cavalier. But even that's a test, constantly aware of it all. My lonely ear, pressed against the walls of your world, praying to catch you whispering. I'm praying you catch me listening.
My name is Bria Griffin.
How old are you?
22.
What are you doing nowadays?
Right now, I am an entrepreneur. I am doing my own business with lashes, so it's just, you know, slowly growing, but we're getting there.
How's that going?
It's going pretty good, actually. Like, you know, people are finding out about me, you know. I think I do pretty well for what I charge, but, you know, it's going great.
All right. So this whole concept is talking to a younger or older version of yourself. Which one would you like to talk to?
Definitely the younger version of myself.
What are you saying to the younger Bria Griffin?
Give yourself time. It all time. If I want to, you know, talk to a certain age, definitely from middle school up until me graduating college, and that was literally last May of 2019. But I know definitely when I was younger, I struggled a lot with self-esteem issues. I did not love myself, didn't like my skin color, didn't like my hair. Anything that you can name about me was just something that I thought was wrong with me. All throughout middle school, I went to an all-white middle school, so literally it was me, my best friend Kayla, and my teacher were the only black people there, so I didn't really see a lot of individuals that looked like myself. So you can imagine struggling with self-image issues and not really seeing a great representation of myself. Never really truly loved myself like I wanted to. Especially growing up, me and my brother and our family, we had a lot of hardships. Struggling with money, not knowing how my parents are going to pay bills or how we're going to eat. Even getting pushed out of our own house and having to live with somebody. We struggled a lot, and that definitely affected my self-esteem, and it's still a journey I'm on now, but it's gotten better. And I just wish, like, you know, I gave myself time to really enjoy who I am, because I didn't, and it definitely affected me throughout high school and even throughout college. So just learning to give myself time, because even going throughout high school, I'd struggle with body image issues. Just like I said, not loving myself, guys looking at me just as a piece of me and never as something, like, you know, an individual. So it was a lot. And, you know, my mom, she only could help me but so much, but it's kind of like one of the things, like, you kind of have to go through it. You can't get over it or go around it. It's something you have to really struggle through and learn. It was definitely something I had to go through on my own. No one could really help me as much as they probably wanted to. And it was just kind of like an inside battle. I didn't really voice to myself. As much as I hate to really bring this up, I won't say to the extent, but I was like somewhat self-harming at a young age. And it definitely wasn't healthy at all. I got frustrated very easily. School didn't come to me easy. I didn't feel like I had a lot of friends in my life. I've never felt like that. So I did some self-harm to myself. And I'm glad I've definitely grown past that. But that was just something, I guess, that helped me kind of got through my issues with low self-esteem. And then going throughout high school, still the same thing. Struggling with self-image issues. And I then known to, like, you know, love myself a little bit more, just because I was surrounded by individuals like myself, such as, you know, black people. Basically, I didn't see that at all growing up, going to, like, you know, charter schools all my life, and I didn't go to public school until I was in high school. I went to high school with my brother. It was great. Had a lot of guys around me that saw me as a little sister, so I got that, you know, protection, all girl love, whatever. But it definitely helped me to grow up as an individual. And, you know, high school wasn't necessarily the pivotal point. Definitely college was for me. when I first made my decision to go to Winston-Salem State University, HBCU, my mom questioned me and asked me, am I sure I wanted to go? Because it was a bunch of black people there. She didn't know how I would be there. I'm like, I'm black, they're black, I don't see much of an issue there. So, you know, starting out my freshman year, going to college, it was great. I loved it, learned a lot about myself, but again, if I'm getting back to my self-esteem issues, this was the first time, obviously, anybody, any young 18-year-olds on their own by themselves, so I was pretty much able to do what I wanted to do. Beginning of the year, you know, you meet people, you meet your so-called friends that you're going to be with for the rest of your life, and they were all bad influence. If I'm being honest, out of the three girls I hung out with, I'm the only one that graduated. I stopped hanging out with them because they wanted to smoke all the time and drink, and I kind of realized that was not the moves I was trying to make in college. It wasn't my thing, it wasn't my move. I didn't want to smoke and drink all the time. I came to school with a goal, yes, to have fun, but, you know, to definitely learn and get an education. And once I stopped hanging out with them, I was by myself all the time, 24/7. I didn't really have a lot of friends then. And I think that's when I really discovered how to be alone. And I think some people definitely struggle with learning how to be alone. And I always try to make sure people understand the difference between being alone and lonely. Just because I'm alone doesn't mean I'm lonely. Like, I have enough comfort within myself that I don't have to bring people around me to make me feel good about myself or feel comfortable. So that was something I definitely struggled with. I cried a lot of nights because I feel like I didn't have anybody in my life to talk to. I didn't really have anybody close then. So that's how I knew how to be by myself. I went to the gym by myself. I went to the library by myself. I went to the cafe by myself. People would literally walk up to me like, Bria, you look lonely. Like, no, I'm not lonely. I'm good being by myself. And a lot of people struggle with that. And I'm grateful to say that, like, you know, that I definitely got through that. Moving on to my sophomore year, which is definitely the absolute hardest thing I ever been through. I went into college as a virgin. I lost my virginity my sophomore year. This guy I was talking to, he definitely put me through a lot. I guess because he was my first and I had such a attachment towards him, he put me through a lot, lying to me. Just my biggest thing was lying. We wasn't boyfriend or girlfriends. I knew that beforehand. I'm very smart enough to know, just because we decided we wanted to have sex, I was smart enough to know he's not my boyfriend, so I'm not gonna sit here and act crazy and be like, you can't do this with anybody else, but at least respect me and my body enough to know, like, hey, if you're going to go around and mess with other girls, at least give me that. No, he didn't give me that. He definitely put me at the lowest point of my life where it was dark for me. It was really dark. When I kind of found out he was messing around with me, and, you know, just put me through a lot of things, I felt like I wasn't clinically depressed, but I felt depressed. I was in my room every day. I went to class and came back and did my work barely, but I was sad. I was so sad because I felt like I gave so much, and I'm a very giving individual, and I do that freely and kindly with nothing in expectation of return. And I think that's where a lot of people need to learn how to do that sometimes, but to the point where they know they're not giving so much that they can't get a piece of themselves back. And I don't regret none of it at all, because I feel like everything that you go through is a lesson. You have to learn and grow from it. And I don't regret nothing I've done, but I do wish, like, you know, things changed and went differently. he made me feel depressed. I literally would cry in the middle of the cafeteria because I would think about how he treated me so bad. I never really had a great father figure example in my life. Yeah, my dad is in my life, but he's not the man that I wish to look up to. And me and him don't have the best relationship. I wish it was definitely better, but I mean, it kind of is what it is at this point. And I feel like if he wants it to get better, then he would do what he needs to do as a father to be closer to his daughter. But I don't have a real example of what a man is supposed to treat me like and how I'm supposed to be taken out. I don't have that. I felt empty. I really felt empty. And, you know, I definitely forgave him over and over again. And it probably is somewhat my fault because learned behavior. I forgave him, still did the same thing. And I still forgave him. But I think what really got me towards the end of the year, once we stopped talking, I was cool with all his friends, and it was into semester, my sophomore year, and I was trying to like do a final, and I went to his room to go hang out with his friends because I'm cool with all of them. So I went down there doing my work, was talking to one of his friends, and one of his friends asked me when, which is a weird question about if I would have sex with him. I was like, I mean, thought about it, cool, yeah, but no, just because y'all are friends. But I think he was kind of drunk. And he took my work, and he went up to my room, and I had to obviously follow him to get my work. But as we went upstairs, went in my room, he locked my door, cleaned my bed off. And he turned the lights off, and he kept moving stuff for me. He was like, come on, come on. And I was just like, no, I'm not having sex with you. I don't want to. And he kept forcing himself on me, and I lay there. I kept trying to run around the room, tell him to stop, and I laid there and I tried to tell him to stop, and I literally was laying there, and I thought he was going to rape me.